Fill her up.
You're listening to the Gas Digital Network.
What up, podcast party people? How you doing? How you living? Doing all right? I hope so. I hope you're doing good. You know why? Because I got an awesome guest today. Great guest. Awesome guest. You know, sometimes when you get these, sometimes you get a guest and they, you know, they got a dirty past, but they don't want to talk about their dirty past. I'll tell you what, man, Shavo didn't give a fuck today. Didn't give a fuck. Was down to talk about everything. I was like, dude, you're awesome. It's so great. It's really great to hear. And I love it when they're more open and, you know, they're not trying to, you know, we've all got our skeletons in our closets, and it was cool, man. Very cool. Great dude. I was going to say, I haven't seen Shavo in, it's been a while. I want to say it's been like 7 years. We've done festivals. We took them out on their first dates outside of California, but then we did tons of festivals. And I want to say the last thing that we did was, the fuck is the name? This festival in Australia. God, what the hell is it called? I'm totally brain farting on what the name of this festival in Australia is. Anyway, it was a festival in Australia. They were on the bill, and I want to say it was about 7 years ago or something like that. But it was cool because we were traveling. We were in the same airports all the time, and we were seeing each other at the hotels, and I was catching the show, and they caught the show, and that was probably the last time that we like had a good hang. I remember after one of the shows, I want to say it was after Melbourne or maybe after. I want to say it was after Melbourne. I totally ended up broing down with the Cavellertak dude, the singer for Cavellertak, and the rest of the band too. This band is super cool. And we ended up at some little dive bar across the street from this hotel, and Shavo and Darren came over. And it was great. It was, you know, they just came over and hung. We just fucking, we were hammered. It was a great time. It was good, just hang. There was, you know, it was very chill, easy, and it was a good hang. And that was probably the last, I was gonna say that's like maybe the last time, I think he might have come to a show, I can't remember, but that was the last time that we had a good like hang. And it's a good vibe, man. So you know, they just dropped some new music, if you haven't heard, Protect the Land, and another song that I can't pronounce very well, but I'll give it a shot once a little later here. But they are, they're raising money to get the land back for Armenia. So check that out. Yeah. Head over to systemofadown.com. They got a whole breakdown of what they're doing there. And, it's good stuff. My month has gone pretty good. We're in February now, finally. And I was trying to do dry January. I got 2 weeks into January and then fell off. I was like, I'm going to drink. And so Fridays and Saturdays, I fell off the wagon, but that's it. I was back on the, come Sunday, boom, I was back on my fucking grind, man. Sunday to Thursday, sober as a judge. And it was good. It was a good little hang. I'm getting into today I had a good workout. I fucking went and grinded hard at the gym. I've been getting back into that. Been eating healthy again. In fact, my coach, Coach Ted, was like, he was telling me some crazy shit today. He's like, I want you to start eating no gluten, no dairy, no sugar, no booze. I was like, no booze? Oh, hell no, Coach Ted. Come on now, Coach. I do a happy hour every Friday. I got a drink. I can't do sober happy hour. It's called the electric happy hour. In fact, before that, when it was just me, it was the Robb Flynn acoustic happy hour. Got to drink a couple of beers, Coach Ted. Oh, but you're going to get the sugar. I know. I don't care. But I'm seriously considering doing no gluten, which I almost already do. I don't really eat a lot of bread. I eat a lot of rice. I eat a lot of quinoa. I'm already eating this weird way anyway. I'm eating 30 grams of protein, 30 grams of carbs, 10 grams of fat 6 times a day. But so I don't eat that much bread already. So I'm thinking that might be easy. No sugar. I do like my creamer in my coffee, but I guess I can give it up. Do like a dark chocolate Reese's peanut butter cup every once in a while too. Guess I'll give those up. And then dairy, man, I eat a lot of yogurt. I eat a lot of Greek yogurt almost every day. That's like one of my, that's one of my biggest things of protein, because I don't want to eat meat fucking 6 times a day. It just grosses me out after a while. So I do have the Greek yogurt. So that might be a little tougher. That might be a little tougher, but I may give it a shot. And then booze is going to have to wait a little bit longer, Ted, Coach Ted. But I may go all in on the other three. I've been having like lots of muscle soreness and fucking joint aching and just fucking some bullshit. I tried this shit called Unify. It's like a fermented, it's this fermented microgreens, and it's supposed to help your gut health. Look at this shit. I don't know if you can see on there. Look at all this. I fucking had a total like allergic reaction. Like I broke out all like over here on my fucking neck over here. I got a thing on my hair, like fucking legs, my feet, like dude, like hives, like full on hives. I was like, what the fuck is this? I'm not allergic to anything as far as I know, but maybe this fermented shit. I did it for like 4 days in a row. And fuck. It's like, all right, I'll just quit this shit. But now I still have these lingering little, oh my God, this thing on my right arm, driving me crazy. It's either that or poison oak. And I do go hiking a lot with the dogs. And so it could be poison oak. And I don't know how I got it all over my body. But yeah, something. What else is going on? It's January 31st, got my mom fully moved out of her place. That's right. Fully moved out of her place now. Was able to either put her stuff in storage or sell off her stuff and make her some money, or, you know, even give it to just some of the old people in the neighborhood. You know, there's this app called Nextdoor. You can put it up there, and like all these old people, like, oh my God, walkers, yay, walkers with a chair. Oh my God, I totally want that. We're like, sweet, you know, here. Somebody took the ramp. There was a little ramp to get into my mom's house, and they took the ramp to like kind of, you know, ease their walker up in there. So they're very, we made some old people very happy. We did. We really made a lot of, and it was kind of heartwarming, you know, kind of get you all a little verklempt, like, oh my gosh. So. Good stuff. And then I guess the one sad thing about that is that we had to let the house go because it was Ginevra. Now, you're not going to understand this if you ain't got kids. Like, if you ain't got kids, you're not going to relate to this at all, because if you don't got kids, you can fuck every, you're fucking in every room of your house. You're fucking in the bedroom. You're fucking in the bathroom. You're fucking in the kitchen, on the fucking couch, living room, everywhere, balcony, anything. When you got kids, Jesus, like you're cordoned off in the room and you're always thinking about, like, hopefully they hear the kids stomping down the hallway. You think they're going to come and mom, dad, where's the food? Or, you know, like they're going to pop in for some bizarre reason. And while it doesn't really bother me that much, it definitely bothers Ginevra. And now my, because the kids are doing the distance learning. We set up the computer in my office for my oldest son, which is now where my office is, which is right next to the bedroom. So that's now where he's also playing video games. So, like, you know, say Ginevra and I want to go in and have a little afternoon delight. Well, on a Saturday when he's off school, now I got 16-year-old kids sitting there screaming at the computer, pounding on the thing with his friends. I'm like, oh, my God. Yeah, so it's hard to, you know, my wife more than I do has trouble concentrating and just relaxing, like just kind of letting her guard down and, you know, f- feeling like, okay, we don't have a lock on the door. We just pile a bunch of pillows in front of the door. We should have a lock. After all this time with kids, we should have a lock, even just like a little latch that goes over to stop the door from opening, but we don't even have that. And reminds me, I should just go get that now. I should just go get it now that the brothel's closed. Now that the brothel is closed. But yeah, that was great. Just go over to my mom's house, do a little bit of work, and then at some point just be like, all right, let's go kick it on my mom's love sofa. Let's go make some love on the love sofa. Oh, it's awesome. No one's going to come in. You don't got to worry about any fucking 16-year-old screaming at their computer. Yeah. And then we got rid of the love seat. The love seat, love sofa, love seat. Yeah, it's like the two person. Oh yeah, on there. Haven't told my mom that we've been having sex on her on her love seat. We had to get rid of that. And then my mom had this little like a single person chair that was electric, and it reclined electrically. It would, you know, lean back all the way, or it would go the other way and help her like out of the chair. Oh my God. This thing was fucking, it literally reclined almost perfectly flat. So Ginevra and I were just all over that thing. We're just like, this is fucking awesome. And like good position. You're kind of propped up like in the, it's just like, this is, so yeah, just tearing that thing to pieces. It's fucking great. But now it's gone. I ended up asking, like, she's at the care facility, like, hey, do you guys need this kind of reclining chair for the care? Like, oh, we could really use it. I'm like, damn it. Fine. Bring our love chair over there. But there we go. I'm going to have to go get a lock on the door now. Why don't I have a lock? I have no fucking idea why I don't have a lock on the door after all these years. Need to go get it. Just a little latch. So if you want to write in, if you want to tell me your stories about making love on your parents' couch or, you know, even Shavo gets into some good stuff on this, man. He talks about, you know, some of his addiction to Xanax and all this stuff. If you want to write in, suggest guests, no effing regrets. podcast@gmail.com. Again, no effing regrets podcast@gmail.com. Or I read the comments. Oftentimes I'll read the comments on here. If you enjoy the podcast and you're listening on Apple, bro, I was number 7 on Apple Podcasts last week or 2 weeks ago. It was sick. You guys, keep giving it the ratings. You can give it the ratings on Apple. That makes it go higher into the algorithm. Leave a comment. Say some good shit. Say, oh my God, this is the best podcast I've ever listened to. All that good stuff. Appreciate it. Appreciate all the feedback. Appreciate the engagement. Glad you guys have been liking it. I know you liked the last Melissa Cross and the Wolf Hoffman. So very, very cool. I'm going to play you. If you don't know System of a Down, you're fired. You're fucking fired. So, tell you what, Shavo helped write this song. Wrote a lot of this song, apparently. This is off their first record. You got to know this song. Can't believe you. Banger right there. Sugar. Beep, 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 beep. Come on, you know sugar. Sugar! I guess he also wrote this song, Toxicity. Yeah, Shavo's he's got quite a few song credits on here, man. Bringing some riffs. Favorite songs right here. Oh yeah, I forgot it's got the intro. Ooh, I forgot about the intro. I love this intro. That's why I just thought it started there. It's been a while since I listened to the record. Yeah, let's get to the vocals. There's a waterfall. We're one in the river and one again after the fall. Shavo's also got a new thing going called North Kingsley. North Kingsley, check this shit out. This song featuring got RZA from Wu-Tang.
Whoa. I don't think anything that I've been hearing is worth it. Yeah. I aim for CNN or the Shapiro internment. 2 feet and I'm running for it. Little foot, big foot like a time before. Better crook halfway, my idols worm. I'm deep, I need that vital word. That punchline, that word slide, that word play. That verse line I heard like Q-tip first time her fight. And the falsetto's my sight. And I'll talk light when I fight. Just be about it, you been about it. We don't gotta act over light. You the boss, huh? Alright, don't just talk tough for the night. Just be about it, if you been about it. We don't gotta act over light.
Here's the number one song called Like That that they dropped. Number one song on Spotify.
Is you even anything I wanna fuck around with? Wait, I'm a chill. I've been having trouble being calm, I gotta tone it down now. Stupid kid, gotta sit still. Knew that when I show up in the motor, I'm a total.
Staying busy. I'm a carpet, I don't wanna deal with the devil in a big. Love this dude's voice, man. So smooth. Got like a cool rasp. Here's one of my favorite System songs. Sad Statue. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to get into it right now with the man, the mighty Shavo Odadjian.
Yeah, I've been trying to go healthy, bro. You know, I'll talk about it. I had COVID, bro. I got COVID. So during COVID, I was like eating anything because I just
recently.
Yeah,
just
bro. Recently? I got over it like a week and a half ago.
Oh my God.
Yeah, dude, it screwed me up, bro. I went into the studio. I had a mask on, and then I took my mask off at some point. I had a drink, you know, smoked a little. And everyone was just doing what they do. I had my photographer double masked the whole time, never took it off. My tech double masked, never took it off. The three of us ended up 3 days later, COVIDed out, like fucking in bed hurting. And they're in Miami partying and none of them have it. I don't know how we got it, you know? It was like the room, the studio got hotboxed. And yeah, right. I think it might've been from the smoke. Cause you know, you inhale, it hits your lungs, comes out. No windows, studio. It was like a car. It was a hot box. When they turned the lights on at the end of the night, it was like just smoke. And I feel like that's why the guys with the masks got it too. Because you're still breathing, you know? And I know that gets through masks, you know? It's like, it's not that easy, but I think through smoke, it might be easy. Anyways, bro, like it was Wednesday night. We were there. Saturday night, I had a throat itch, a little scratchy throat. And then Sunday morning, I woke up floored, like something's wrong. And I had these indoor at-home tests that I had gotten because we had some scares. My nanny got it when I was in Vegas, and then we didn't have her come through. So I had these tests come in just in case we got it. We did the test. Been a negative, negative. Sunday morning, bro, I put it in, tested it out. Positive. Blast, like, boom, here you are, bro. You're fucked.
Fucker.
So yeah, I was just, oh my God, bro. So what do I do now? I had seen my folks the day before. I was concerned. Yeah, bro, they're older, you know, you never know. They're in their 70s, you know, so I was so worried. The anxiety level goes crazy because you don't know what's going to happen to you. Everyone, they tell everyone, everyone reacts differently, you know? So there's this pounding headache that kicks in, bro. 3 days straight, like 60 hours. Nonstop headache. Body aches, neck. That's what happened to me, bro. And then like, so a week ago I was, it was the 10 days past. I felt better after the eighth day. There was no I didn't get the lung. I never coughed. I never got a fever. So
you had a split headache for 3 days straight, huh?
Worst headache ever I've ever had. Tylenol, nothing. Doesn't do shit.
Did you lose the taste? You know, it's a big
I lost smell. I still don't have smell.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Like, I just can't smell. It's crazy. I do essential oils and shit. Nothing. Incense, nothing. Candles, I can't smell. Weed, I can't smell my weed.
That's crazy.
It's insane. It's a weird feeling when you're like, you know that there's a smell there and you're like this and nothing. So, I mean, some things are better because you don't smell, you know, but, shit don't stink, you know?
Your shit don't
stink. Literally. Literally my shit doesn't smell right now. But other than that, it's kind of a weird thing, psychological thing, you know, but, thank God I'm on the other side. I feel like a million bucks. I don't have that after effects of like people saying they're tired forever and they're still coughing and all that shit didn't happen to me.
So, right. Yeah. Now
I'm immune and non-transmittable. So I'm at the best place I could be, you know?
Yeah. So, yeah. You don't got to worry, I think, for like 5 months or something.
Four to 6 months, they're saying. And I have the antibody test too I'm doing. So it's full on there. My antibodies are there. There's no possible way I can get COVID right now.
Yeah, I had it back in February. We went through New York. We were on tour, went through New York, and that was the hot spot at the time. I mean, it was just like every single person in the band and crew came down. I mean, we were fucking laid out, dude. Just
everybody got it.
Devastated.
And in February, you didn't even know what it was. You didn't even know what it was.
We had heard about it. We actually got tested for it, but they gave us the result back in like 5 minutes. And, you know, like back in February, nobody was giving coronavirus results back that fast.
Of course not. So, So you guys tested positive in five minutes?
They said that they didn't even come back with a positive or a negative. They said they tested us for it and that we didn't have it.
Mm. So,
Whatever.
And
we all had the same thing. We all had the cough. We all had the just fucking chills, just laid out in bed for fucking, you know, Logan and I were sleeping like 17 hours straight. Logan waking up and Logan got it. Dude. The healthiest fucking guy, right?
He's my inspiration. Dude's my inspiration. Dude was working out when I was still getting fucked up. Like I was hanging out with him. I used to do a lot of crazy shit. You know, I got into that. And him and I were, I got a lot of stories with Logan, bro. Him and I got really tight for a while. He was sharing my studio space for Once Human and stuff. And I was going to be in that band, bro. I was going to be in that band for a second. I was in it for a second. But at the time I was using and I was drinking, I was in a bad place, bro. And I couldn't even focus, bro. There was no possible way. I couldn't do nothing new. You know, it was at a time where it was before I got sober and stuff. So, but he had my back, bro. So I'll give him all props for that. He was really like watching after me. He saw me getting into the worst situation. I think the worst time I've ever had with alcohol and drugs was when he was in my life and he was watching it and he was like really distraught by it, bro. And I feel like something that I always like know that he's my homie because of that. You know, he didn't judge me. He cared about me. And he fully, that's when right. He saw me go in and got better, he was the happiest out of anyone. You know,
that's awesome. Yeah, because he went through a rough patch too, man. Like he was bad. Like super bad.
I know.
I can't wait to have him on the podcast to just talk about how bad it was.
That was, you know? I remember. I was around.
It was pretty bad. So like to have him get clean and then see you in a state, you know, it's like you're seeing your friend and like you connect with it in this way that I don't know if anybody else could because you just went through it.
Yeah. Yeah. It's tough, bro. I see it now. I know people that are still in it and I'm going, fuck, bro. All you have to do is just be, just determine yourself just to do it and be consistent and just do it. You can, it's possible. It's not like it's impossible, but when you're in the zone, you think it's impossible. There's no life without it. You know, you think you're not going to be good at artistically. Cause you know, for us, we make music and we do art. And what happens is you start, associating what you're doing with being under the influence. So you're like, if I'm not under the influence, maybe I can't do what I do. You know, I started thinking that my artistic senses were only lit when I was lit. There was no If I got sober, I wouldn't be able to create. That's how I started thinking. So it was kind of a crutch, you know, that crutch was there. And then it got to a point where it took over me. I did a podcast back then. There was no podcast happening. I was doing it through the same studios in Burbank with Logan was there. And I would get fucked up and start talking to people. And I had important people on the podcast. I don't remember a thing about it, bro. And it never went anywhere. It was just because I was just in my own world thinking that it sounds good, but it really didn't because, you know, everyone else saw me in that way. And I saw me in another way. You know, it's like your own perception is totally twisted, you know? So
I was just reading about, and I didn't really know this. I mean, and not that it surprised me, but just that you were on Xanax for a really long time, like Xanax.
20 years.
Yeah, 20 years. Dude, yeah. I mean, my fucking jaw dropped when I heard that. That's a really long time to be on that and a very heavy, you know, very heavy.
And it wasn't for fun. It wasn't like I was like the kids nowadays that they're doing, they're popping pills, they're partying. I wouldn't do it to party. It was something that was prescribed to me when I was 20 years old, 21 or 22. And it was when we started touring and I had a little bit of anxiousness, bro. I was still living with my parents. They would pick us up in an RV. I would go all over we went with you guys. We were with you guys in Vegas. Remember that the infamous Halloween show that I still talk about, bro. I give you guys all the credit of taking us out of LA for the first time. And so I was at a little anxiety and the doctor's like, well, take this, you know, and prescribed me 90 of them a month. So I was like, oh, since the doctor says I could take 3 a day, then I can. It's not a problem. And I didn't take 3 a day in the beginning. I was just like, okay, a little bit of anxiety, boom, okay, gone. Now I'm chilling. Now I smoke weed, you know. And it became that thing where it was in the corner pocket constantly. And every time I didn't do it, I would get anxiety. And then I would think that I have an anxiety issue, but it wasn't. It had become withdrawals at that point. And I had no idea that withdrawals and anxiety are the same feeling, pretty much the same exact feeling. So I was thinking I was curing my anxiety, but I was literally feeding my addiction, bro. So it was such a bad catch 22. And it was just like, had to do it. It got really bad towards the end at that time I'm talking about with Logan and stuff, because I started doing other stuff. You know what it does? I said this in another interview a while ago, I think a year or two ago. It compresses you. Like it compresses your emotions. It takes away all the negative stuff, of course, but it also takes away the positive. So you feel like this, and me, I'm an energetic, like fun loving. I talk a lot. I like to be like in the middle of a creative, you know, I'm like to talk with my hands. It made me like this. And it made me like to not. So if I wanted to feel something, I drink, I do blow, I do this, I do just to feel something. It was like, in order to get that spike, I would have to do something or else I was compressed. I called it a soul compressor in another interview. It was like, compressed you like a bass compressor, you know? Yeah. And so
that's a good way to describe it, man. It's so true.
It's and it was a life thing, you know. It wasn't, and then when I talked about getting off of it, a lot of people were like, you cannot do it by yourself at home. You can die. You've been doing it for so long. And I was like, bro, I just wanted it out of me. I don't want it anymore. I don't want to feel that way. So I checked myself in, bro. I checked myself in. I didn't tell anyone. Everyone in my family, I said, I'm going to produce a band in New York. So I told everybody. And I went to New York. I didn't go to New York, though. I went in. And I went, checked myself. It was supposed to be 30 days. Once the 30 days passed, I said, I'm going to stay for 15 more, bro. I want to make sure I'm like, I was determined. That was what it was. I was like, I'm done with this. I'm done with being dependent on anything. Like, I don't want to be dependent, bro. I like to be independent. And so I stayed for 45 days, checked out 2 days before my birthday in 2016. And I've never looked back, bro. I swear. I smoke weed and that's it. I have a little drink here and there, which I can, because I don't take it to the next level because I don't need to. I'm not compressed. Like, I have my emotions. Coffee's my best friend. I smoke some weed. I, you know, I have 22 red. And that's something that's never been a problem for me. Weed never took anything out of my life that was good. You know, it just, you know, everyone around me knows that it's never been a grudge. Yeah. It's been cool. Like I can handle it. My personality is cool with it. Cause I'm so hyped. It kind of brings me in a cool little level, you know? And yeah, bro. So it's the best thing I've ever.
That's,
Thank you. That's best thing I've ever done, bro. I swear, besides having kids and being a dad, that's the next step of like best thing I've ever done for myself.
Was this all kind of around the same time of having kids? Like, was all of this kind of
pretty much leading up? Yeah. I had two kids. I had my boys. One was like almost a year old and the other one was like 3 or 4. And that's when I checked myself and I was like, they won't remember this. They'll probably see this interview and they'll be like, oh shit, you didn't go to New York, Dad. But that was the thing, you know, I didn't want anyone to remember me like that, bro. My kids, I want them to see me like the way I am, you know, the real Shavo, you know, the one that's like responsible. I love having goals and completing them. I love to create. I'm a good family guy. I stand for justice, you know, good stuff in my life. And when you're under the influence, sometimes that shit takes over all that, you know? And so thank God, bro, whatever God's out there, I thank that.
Yeah. I mean, I remember a couple of times when I was, you know, I've gone through my sober phase. I got, you know, I was hitting it hard. I got sober. Now I'm kind of somewhere just kind of ease. I'm on about the same level as you. I don't smoke weed,
you're
but just
kind of, you know,
drink with the wife and chill out.
You'll have your wine. Yeah.
I'll have my vodka.
Vodka's great. But just vodka sometimes takes me to that other fucking level where I'm like a little too messed up. Yeah,
I have my two drinks and then I have a couple beers and then I'm good. I'm just that's it. I remember I came home one time, man, and I was like, both my kids were really young and I went out to a show and I had fucking drank a bunch and I had done a bunch of blow and I came home and I just remember like my kid got up right as I came home and I'm like trying to be cool and like, oh yeah, hey buddy, let me I got two boys too, so I was like, hey, let me kind of help you out here. And I just remember being like, what the fuck are you doing? Like, what the fuck am I doing? Like, I can't do this. Like, I'm a dad. Like, this is way beyond, you know, fucking pull your ass. Pull your shit together, dude.
I've been there many times where I'm just like, shit. Now, like, I don't want them to remember me being weird. And you know, when you're on that zone of like, I'm coming down, am I not? Am I still going to go? And you're feeling awkward and you're around people that are not in your level. It's not good, bro. It was fun when we were young and we were on tour and we were doing what we do and no one was judging us or no one was expecting anything from us but that, you know?
Such an asshole 20-year-olds.
Man, we were given the ability to, so we're allowed that, you know? I mean, I don't blame any one of us for any of that. Cannot blame the person because the person is a good person. You know, you've always been the righteous dude that you are right now.
Thank you.
Whether you've been on high or you've been on low, you've been the guy you are. And me too. I'm always going to be this guy, bro. Don't want that time of my life to represent any of my, you know, my personality in any way to anyone around me. That's special.
When you have a kid, it's like your life becomes so much about the kid. It's not about you. And, you know, and up until that, in some ways, like I'm often, you know, it often makes me think what someone would be like. I got a bunch of people I know in bands who never have kids, right? Like they're 50 years old. They never had a kid. And I'm like, I just wonder what your life would be like. I think you might have been happier in some way because like life isn't about you anymore. It's not just about you. It's about something bigger than you. That's way more fucking important than you.
Yeah. Way more than you. I mean, we earn money. It's not about me anymore. I don't worry about loot because of what I can buy for myself anymore. It's about, am I going to be able to give these guys everything they need for the rest of their life and until they're ready to do it for themselves? That's where it's at. Why I grind, why I have businesses, why I want to, like, why I'm so driven is for that now. So I can support them forever and give them everything they need. And that's what makes me happy, to be able to make them happy. And never have them worry. That's kind of like this thing I have. And that's what it is, man. That's what drives me. Not personal stuff. Because I remember when it was just for me, bro, I would blow that stuff away. Like, whatever. Everyone was my, you know what I mean? My house back then, the door was revolving. Come in. My jewelry was out. I didn't care. Take it. Whatever. I got jacked at my own house, man. The studio back then with the RZA would come through and everybody was all around. It was like everyday party, everyday people recording in my house. It didn't matter. I would spend the money, did not care. It was coming from me, going to me, going away from me. Now, I have a different mentality. It's family, it's the kids, it's my wife. I want to make sure I want to make sure they got what they got forever, you know?
Yeah.
So different.
Tell me about you. You got a lot of, got a lot of rods in the fire, man. You got the North Kingsley, you've got the 22 Red, you've got a weed strain that you're,
yeah,
you know.
The 22 is the weed thing, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
So tell me about all that stuff. So, I checked out the North Kingsley, man. Your fucking rapper is sick, dude.
Thank you,
He's
bro.
Got some sick flows. He's, killer voice. Like, his voice is super smooth. And
I appreciate that. He's a punk rock singer. He's a metal guy. He's young. He's 30. Wow. And he's like all crazy metal punk. He used to be a punk rock screamer. He screams, yells.
Oh, wow. Crazy.
And one day he rapped for a joke. And his friends were like, dude, like, what the fuck? You can do this. And he just went with it. Yeah.
Really good lyrics. Like, really good lyrics, you know, like, you know, I like where he's coming from.
With what I appreciate that. Ray Hawthorne. Yeah.
Yeah.
His name is Ray Hawthorne. He's from Jersey. I think from Camden area. You know, we know that area very well with Burchill and shit. Remember that? All the chaos that would go down there. So yeah, dude, I met the producer, Sorrow, who makes the beats. I met him because I wanted to, at some point I got sober. So this is how it all started. I got sober and I had nothing. I had no projects. I had system that was farting out because I could actually went in because the three of us got together, John, Darren and I, to write music and says, if Serge ever comes around, we're going to show him all this new music, right? And we got in and I think I was at my worst then. I think I was like, I was even doing like nitrous and shit. Like I was just doing shit just to not be who I am. For some reason, I was just escaping shit. And they were worried, bro. You know, they've known me for 20 some years, 30 years almost. They were just, so John was like, dude, you got to go in, bro. You got to do it. I'm like, fuck, man. And I did. We stopped recording, rehearsing, and I went in. When I went in, I had to become like bear again. I had to become like, I surrendered. I was just like, okay, do what you got to do with me and make me better, bro, because I can't do this on my own. And once everything was out of me, I was detoxed and I started thinking, I was like, bro, like, I want a project. I want to do system again. I want to get these guys back. I want to have another outlet. I want to have a business. Why not? Why can't I have a business? Something I believe in, something I attach myself with. So when I got out, it all started and I quit smoking right away. I was weighing 220 pounds. I was, which I've never weighed that much.
That's big for you, man. Like you're a skinny dude.
I have pictures. I have pictures where I hid from the world, bro. I swear. It was always like, does this angle look better? You know, it was like that, bro. I was worried. I'm 163 right now. Like I was 220. And I ate my ass off in rehab. I was just like, they had a chef. So I just kept eating my cravings away, you know? And I smoked a lot of cigarettes. I was smoking 2 packs a day of just regular cigarettes. So anyways, I got out and the first thing was get rid of the cigarettes. So I was like, I got out of Xanax. I can get out of anything. I can do anything. It was like empowering. It felt strong. I was stronger as a person going, dude, I quit that shit. The shit that made me, the things I felt in detox, getting out of, I'm going back to Xanax because it was so crazy. The detox of that drug is worse than any other drug, bro. People on heroin were coming in. And they were out of there in 3-4 days. They were just like already like they did their whole sleep, puking, whatever it was, sweats. They got out of it. Now they're feeling fine, having coffee, having a cigarette. And I'm still just like, my body feels.
Were you so when you're detoxing on Xanax, do you have any of the, like throwing up? Are you, you know, like
no,
any of that?
No. It's chills. It feels like anxiety. It's the worst anxiety I've ever had. It was 2 weeks of non-stop crazy anxiety. My body felt like, you know, when you sit on your leg or your arm and you're like, and then you get out, it's all tingly, that tingly feeling, physical from head to toe, feeling that for like days. Like I'm thinking I'm dying, bro. I was at some point, I thought I was dying. Anyways, having finished, done that, and I'm over it. Now I'm strong. I feel like cigarettes are nothing, done. I'll never take another puff again. Got rid of it. Haven't looked back once. It's been 5 years now. Then I was like, it was my kids. We were christening my boys. And I had to put a suit on. And I realized nothing fits me, bro. I was just like, it was like, my zipper was like that. Like,
you weighed 165. Didn't fit you.
None of that shit fits me, bro. I'm like, what am I going to wear? And I felt all bad. So I kind of like felt bad about myself for a second. But I was like, nah, dude, I've done that. I did cigarettes. Now I'm going to do this. So I went on Google and I Googled health and I Googled weight loss. And I just read, it was like, okay, lower your fat content, lower your intake, lower your carb intake, lower your sugar intake. That was the common denominators were fat, sugar and carbs. Okay. So and workout. So I've never worked out in my life, bro. Never. I only on stage. I had that whole skinny cut because I used to do so much cardio and didn't eat, you know? So I was like, fuck, dude, I'm going to do it. I had a belly, you know, big, big belly. I just got myself checked into Equinox. I got a trainer for a couple times a week. And I just started this meal prep where it was like 400 calories every meal. I had four of those. You know what
love
I mean?
Love
the meal prep, bro. That's the only way I did it. All day. Because like you don't have to be worried about Postmates. You don't got to worry about going and get food. It's like there for you if you need it. And you know that it's good for you. You know it's not going to, you know, blow you up because you don't know what you're getting on. You know, they say it looks healthy. The burrito looks healthy, but then it's got like 1,000 calories. You can't eat three times a day, 1,000, then you're overweight already. A male, I realized it has to be 2,000, what is it? 2,400 calories or lower, you lose weight, something like that. So anyway, I did the math. Dude, I lost 60 pounds, bro, in like 7 months. I was just like, fuck. Now I'm doing that? Like, what's next? Like, now I started a checklist of things I want to do in my life. Like, I was like, fuck, got rid of the drugs, got rid of the smoking. Now I got rid of the weight.
Lost weight, yep.
What's next? I was like, let's start a business. Let's do something.
You know what? I was curious, though. What was being off of Xanax like, though, now? Like, I mean, now you're feeling emotions. You know, you're feeling sadness.
Oh, now the anger, that's a good question. Anger was like angry. Happy was like really happy. Too happy. People are like, whoa, dude, chill the fuck out. Like, relax. It was extra Shavo. It was like Shavo here, like Shavo plus. It was just like too much, you know? Sadness.
Like when you were sad, were you just like super like on the verge of fucking
crying?
Falling.
Yeah. Like happiness would make me cry. Sadness would make me cry. Anger would make me cry. It was just like emotion, too much emotion overload.
But in some way, though, I would imagine that you're maybe grateful for that, though, at the time, like having been like what you went through now, it's like, holy shit, I'm actually fucking feeling all of this.
It was good to feel again, bro. Even though it was extreme, it just felt good to feel, to have a feeling, to have emotions was great because for so long, I thought my emotions were caused by drugs and alcohol, bro, because of the Xanax, you know, the Xanax was just an underlying thing that always I thought it was doing me, it was helping me, you know? It's like I felt confident knowing I have a pill in my pocket that if I ever get nervous, I can take that and be fine. And I'm sure people listening to this are relating to what I'm saying, bro. There's hundreds, thousands out there that feel this. When I said this in the interview a while back, there was a bunch of people that were like, wow, bro, I feel you. I'm there now. What do you advise, you know? If I can help one person, bro, I love that. That's so, you know, self-satisfying that I can help people because I needed the help. I got the help. Now I can help others. It's great. You know?
It's a weird drug too. Like that goes psychotropics. Is that what they're called?
Benzodiazepines.
Yeah. But I think I think that they fall under the umbrella of psychotropics or something.
Yeah, I haven't heard that one before. Yeah.
I went through a Xanny phase.
I started with value. That was the first.
Yeah.
Volume than Xanax, anyhow,
I remember going though, like I was on a binge for a while. I was on a bender of those, mm-hmm. And I remember just at one point looking at myself in the mirror and being like I was just looking at my pupils and I was like, who is this person? Like I don't feel anything now. Like I don't feel happy. I don't feel sad. I don't.
That's the compressor.
What the fuck is this? Like this sucks.
And it's so easily prescribed, bro. You go to a doctor right now and you say, I have a little bit of anxiety. They'll fucking, boom, there you go. Ativan, the same shit. Valium, same shit. Xanax, they'll give it to you in a second, bro. Not a problem for them to prescribe it because they probably get paid in the back end, you know?
You've got this newfound clarity. You're like, I need to do something. So the North Kingsley thing starts coming together.
So what happened was I wanted to make music. So I had gotten a studio. And I had put all my old studio, because I had this other studio with Logan. Logan was sharing it with me for a while. It was in Burbank. I needed to get out of there because it was a dungeon. We called it the dungeon, the dungeon in the attic, because it was an attic where the
dungeon
in the attic, because it was lower ceilings. We had to walk like this.
The one that's on like Hollywood, or it's on Melrose or something, right? Like
it was in Burbank, bro. It was right by the Burbank Airport, right across from Hollywood Way, and it was a great place because I had like different rooms. It was like you walk up the stairs and then there was a room on the side, another room in the back. I gave Logan that room. I had a room where I had all my, because I got a lot of gear, bro. So I had all my gear, records. I had a DJ set. I had the drum set. I just walk in there and be creative, whatever you want. Oh, I'm going to play drums right. I'm going to play guitar right. I'm going to play bass. I'm going to DJ. But it was all under the influence and I couldn't stay there anymore. It brought back all the old energies. And it's spooky, bro. When you go back to an area where you used, you know, and I did some other creepy shit too. There was other drugs I did that were just one-offs, but would they stay in your memory when it's hallucinogenics? I did hallucinogenics. That's what I mean by creepy shit. And they stay there. And when you walk in, you sometimes flash back to how you felt. And it's not a good feeling. So I had to clear it up. Found a great space in North Hollywood. Moved my shit in there. And I know Pro Tools, but I wanted to get into some newer programs. And I know Logic, and there's also Reason and all this stuff. So I just try to get into something new. And there's an old friend of mine that I had, Dave, his name is. And I hit him up. He had a studio in Studio City. I was like, man, maybe we should work together. We haven't done anything I've known you all my life. We started playing bass and guitar together. Maybe we should jam, you know, see what happens. Went to his studio. We started jamming. It didn't really go anywhere. We kind of butt heads a little bit on what style of music we wanted to do each, you know, nothing bad. But then I met Saro, who was working in another room. And he knew Logic like the back of his hand. So I was like, this kid could teach me something, man. So I was like, why don't you come over to my house, my studio, and just show me what you got. Like, show me Logic. Show me how to work it. I think I can catch on to it. And I'm going to make my own music. He came in 2 sessions later. We had this beat going that was, in my imagination, was perfect. It just worked out. I was like, why don't we just work together, bro? You run it. I come up with, you know, I'll play guitar, bass, come up with this new genre of hip hop. I never want to do rap metal because, you know, from our era, bro, that shit's been done. It's been played out. We know that from the 90s and 20s. I never want to do it. It's been done. But creating a new genre of hip hop might be cool if we use like the hip hop beats and throw guitars over that instead of using a real drummer and throw rap over rock. Right. Let's throw rock over rap and see what happens, you know? So that's what it is. And because I've always loved hip hop, bro. Like, good hip hop's always got part of me. I love metal, bro. I'm fucking into you guys, Slayer. I'm fucking Sepultura, Obituary. I'm a fanatic of that. Morbid Angel,
Cypress Hill.
There you go.
Enemy,
those are my guys.
Ice Cube, like all that shit. The DOC.
That's how I started, bro. So that's both those groups are like equal to me, you know? So I was like, something, I got to do something that's true to my heart, you know? And originally it was just going to be us making beats and us making music and then bringing in vocalists that I know. I would have brought you in. Maybe I should bring you in. You got to do something. Maybe we do like a chorus with you in it, you know, in North Kingsley. Maybe hard. It might be bad. So see, this is good shit. So I thought maybe I can share the music with vocalists that I know. You know, bring in Be Real, bring in RZA, bring in people I know. And he brought Ray in, our singer. And I was like, dude, like what you just said, this guy's got the words, he's got the flow, he's cool, not egomaniac, totally cool guy, bro. Like, I can work with him.
He's got like a really good timber, you know what I mean?
Rasp.
Like,
he has rasp going on, that's serious, you know, you can't take him lightly. So bro, that was it. It was the birth. It just started, and they're so open to me working with them and molding them. They're young, you know, so they're like, dude, you do what you do with us, you know, like mold us, we're here. So I signed them to a production deal because I don't care about just the unit. If they do something solo, you know, I want to help. I want to build. I want to make them. It's that producer sense, that the Spidey senses that comes out. Like, I want to work. I want to help them out, you know? And the rest is history, bro. We started making music, and we're in, like, I think we're on our 15th track. We've dropped 6.
Yeah.
I had this new concept of, like, how to drop music. I was like, you know, like, the rappers are doing, like, 1 track at a time. I was like, what if we do 3 tracks? Split the 12 song album into 4 volumes, 3 by 3, every other month, every 3-4 months, give people time to marinate on the new style and to like it and appreciate it, listen to all 3 songs then move on to the next three songs. Instead of giving them 12 songs at once, this new project of Shavo from System of a Down, and then have them like listen to it once, attach themselves to two songs, and then the other 10 songs go to waste, and then I got to start a new album, you know, which is what happens to all new artists. Yeah, I love it. I love it. Three by three. Give them time to marinate, love it, hate it, whatever. Make videos for every song. I love, you know, me and videos, bro. I love to direct. I love to be a part of the visuals of the audio. And
yeah, the videos for the one with RZA in it. Yeah. Very cool.
False Idols. That came up. That film right behind my house, bro. There was, I'm in Burbank up in the hills. I found a spot on Latuna Canyon that was like this haunted house, literal haunted house, that they let you to go film in. So it's like all broken and burned. It was an old burned house. Yeah. We went and fucking had fun in there. Crashed.
So cool. The walls were, I was like, wow, that's a fucking rad wall.
We could do whatever we want in here. And they didn't mind if we thrashed up more of it because it just makes it look crazier, you know? So yeah, I was working with a company back then, a few months ago, the Crowd Control, and they have a crew. So I hired them for a little while and had them work with it. So anyways, bro, long story short, the project came to life. I'm proud of it. But the way I see it is like I dropped six songs. I'm checking out the way people feel about it. I'm getting the analytics, who likes it, what they like, what they don't like. And I'm kind of mending. So I just pulled back the other six songs that I was going to drop for volume 3 and 4. I'm going to add a couple of features in there. I've been working with Trippy. I've been in contact with this new kid. I don't know if you heard of Mario Judah. Have you heard Mario Judah? It's this new kid, bro. He's bringing metal into hip hop. Like he's just like this, he screams and yells, but he sings. He has a singing voice, you know, and he yells, and it's like metal on top of like the new hip hop. So it's perfect. So I've been talking to him. I hit him up on DM on Instagram. He reached right back out. Was like, dude, fuck yeah. Like, let's make some noise together, bro. You know, like I can see what you're doing. I think it fits the mold. If you're interested, let's do something together. I'll do something for you. You do something for me. He's been hitting me up.
It is kind of how the rappers, the young rappers are really kind of embracing like the crazier elements of metal and kind of bringing the look in and bringing some of the styling.
Yeah. So if you go look into Mario Judah now, you'll see what I mean. Like the kid's like metal. He looks like a punk. Like his music should be fucking like Bad Brains. He looks like a Bad Brains member. He looks like a Bad Brains member straight up. He could be HR. Right. You know what I mean? So I love that, you know, and you know, it's like, so I decided volume 3 and 4, we're going to chill a little bit. I might cut the songs a little shorter. I think I have long songs. The songs are kind of long. Attention deficit is really a problem now with people. They can't handle a 4-minute song anymore, bro.
Even for me.
It's hard to hear a full album. Bro, I'm going to work.
I think that's really good what you're doing. We've been doing a similar thing. We've been doing just singles, and it's fucking, dude, it's awesome. You know,
isn't that great? Love it.
Constant stream of music rather than, you know, a big thing and then
nothing. Big drop and then nothing for a long time, right?
Especially now with not being able to tour it, like it really is a great way to keep that constant engagement. You know, like,
yes, I love that. That was the point. And then all of a sudden, our first drop was going to be in April. That's when they closed everything down. So we waited. Then I was going to do it in May. And then May, the George Floyd shit happened. So I pulled back. I finally released it in August. The second one I released in December, I think, right? December 4th, I think I did it, the second volume. So, and we haven't been able to, because we want to always take it live too. I think we're going to be really good. I'm playing guitar and bass. So if we take it live, I'll probably get a player, someone that can do both. And I'll figure out what track I'll play what to. You know, it's like, this is something good for me because, like, you know, I'm a bass player. Everyone knows me. I've never played guitar on stage. I mean, I have, but it's been for like featuring, like, with Metallica, I did it once. I did it with some other bands. Like, I love playing guitar. I love it. I started with guitar. I never was a bass player. I was a guitar player. I played my first riffs on the guitar when I was 13. Yeah. I picked up the bass at like 18. And then I joined System. We started System at like 20. So it was like, I was only playing for 2 years when we started System. So I always...
Does a family member pass you on a guitar or something? Like, how
my
do you
grandma did. My grandma, she was like, because I kept begging for a guitar my whole fucking life and my parents wouldn't buy it. They were just like anti me being a musician because I think it's the old Armenian mentality of like musician's going to be always a starving musician, you know? And they would, it's the old mentality that he should go to school, he should be a doctor or a lawyer.
Right.
But I had different things in mind. I was, you know, I was good. I was like a B student, not really, I wasn't that brain, you know? I was a thinker, you know, more of a thinker and a doer. I like to do things. But I was very creative and I always wanted to play. I saw Kiss at age 5 and I was like, that's it for me, bro. If you can do that for a living, I want to do that. You know, like, fuck, you can wear makeup and play music and perform and that's it. It's over.
It is amazing how many fucking bands that goddamn band has influenced.
You know, right? Who would have thought?
How many bands Kiss has inspired to, you know?
I swear I didn't even know what their music sounded like. Yeah. At 5, I didn't know what their music even sounded like. It was what they were doing. Yeah, I didn't even care for their music. I was like, fuck, blood, fire,
so crazy. Yeah.
It's over. Yeah, bro. So that's how it started, bro. So in this band, since I'm doing guitar and bass, and by the way, when I write with for like system and shit, when I've written anything, I write the riffs and I arrange and then I present, you know? To the band, like here, like I brought Toxicity in. I brought it in as riffs, and then Darren took it in, arranged it up, chopped something up. Boom, here's the song. I'm like, fuck, because Darren's that. Darren is a singer-songwriter. Like, since he could sing, he can also write vocals over music. I can't do that. I'm not a singer, so I can probably write the riffs, think of a melody, but not really put it together the way. So it was a good team. We had a great team going. For this, I'm doing it differently, bro. I have all this stuff written, but I don't use it. I kind of am using like just spur of the moment. Like he'll play me a new beat and then that beat will, I'll just grab my guitar or bass and I'll just sit there and he'll press record and I'll just go. And then within that, some crazy shit will come out and I'll be like, cut that 8, cut that 4, put it together. Right. All of a sudden we got this crazy thing going on and then work. So then he'll take the beat and he'll write a beat according to what I played. So then the beat will now change, adapt to what I hear. You know what I'm saying? So a simple beat will be my inspiration. And then what I gave him will be inspiration for him to create a better beat under it. And then vocals go on top. It's a cool little method that, you know, we've been using. Yeah, it's so refreshing, you know, because it's nothing I'm like worried. I know I can go in and it's going to come out. Something's going to come out. If it doesn't, it doesn't. Tomorrow it will, you know?
It must be fun doing it spontaneously like that. Like, very I don't know what the fuck. Doing, I'm just gonna, you know, blah, put it together, and you're like, holy shit! Like,
how did I do that? Yeah, how did that happen? Like, I couldn't. Like, he'll bring us something back a 2 sessions later, and be like, remember you did this? I'm like, no, I don't remember that moment, but I did it because it's there, right? So it's really cool, really refreshing. It's fun because everyone knows what we do in this situation. No one's trying to do what the other person does. There's no ego. It's like, let's just make music together and have fun, you know? And that's what we're doing. And can't wait to see where it goes, man. It's just, it feels great creatively. And but North Kingsley happened after 22. So at first I did 22, you know, like I said, I got out, I got after I'm fresh and clear now. And I wanted to do a brand, like something. I love streetwear shit. I collect sneakers. So I was like, let's do something in that vein, you know? And I have a best friend I've known since like 5 years old, Mike. He owns a clothing manufacturing place called Madewell, LA. We were gonna do some clothing line. We're gonna do something. And then he said, listen, remember this dude we know? He's a great grower. Let's go check out his thing. Maybe bring him in. Sure. I didn't even think about it. You know how many times I've been asked to do weed? Like, I just never wanted to enter the weed game. I was like, I smoke it, bro. I don't want to grow it. You know what I mean? It's just like, I don't know how they're going to handle my strain. You know what I mean? I don't want to put my name on something I'm not in control of, you know? But this, once I went and saw his spot and I saw his like passion, the way I have passion for things I work on, like, dude, we can be like a lifestyle weed brand. Like this was 2017. It was just becoming recreational in California, you know? It was still medical. You know, so I hired a company to come up with a name and to do branding. Like, I swear I went there. I was like, I'm going to let the professionals take care of this. Bro, they came up with garbage, right? Like weird shit. Right? I'm like, not into that, bro. I was like, they'd come and have meetings and then they come to me and with a presentation of like
an advertising agency to come up with a name for a company.
Yeah, like a branding agency, right? So, and they would be like, Urban Legend.
I'm like, wowie.
yeah, urban legend, like that's isn't that a movie? Like, no, I said, throw me into a meeting before you have that presentation to me. Put me in there. I'm a creative. So they put me in the meeting right before. 30 minutes later, 22 Red is born. And it was just because 22, I'm born April 22nd. 22 has always been a number in my life showing up. I got married May 22nd. I was 22 when System got picked up. That was 22 years prior to when I thought of 22, right? I was 44. So I was like, wait, that's 22 and a half, right? 22, two twos make right. 44. And then I realized my boys, bro, one is born September 8th, one is born September 30th, 2 years apart. That's 22 days. So it's 2 years and 22 days apart, my boys. The twos are like everywhere.
Yeah.
So I went with 20. I go, it's got to be something 22. And then we were talking about other things, and I explained how I have this thing. I didn't know it was even a there was even a name for it, but I associate colors with like numbers and letters. I don't know why. Like, numbers have always had a color. Every number has a color in my head. I didn't know it's everyone black. Was black. No, well, a number is black. So nine is black.
Okay.
Weird, right? See, I just thought of that, and I never. It's just like I'll think of a number, and it'll be a color. Two's always been red. So when I was talking about it, one of the guys goes, So what color is two? And I'm like, red, 22 red. Boom. There it is. That's the brand, you know?
And you got your own strains of weed. Like all, and this yeah. is like a custom Shavo flavored or whatever.
Everything. You know? What we do is I started off with like rated, I guess, the word. I teamed up with a distribution and a grow that had weed. And I picked, let's say, three of my favorites at the time. And we renamed them at the time. That's how we started, you know, before we had our perpetuity. Like we right now have our own strains that we create, you know, like we breed, you know, I'll take a mom and a dad and then we'll see what happens. It takes a while. It's not quick. It's like each seed is like takes about 8 to 10 weeks. And then you have to, all these seeds come out and then you have to plant those seeds. Then you have to, every seed's like a kid, like say you get the mother and the father, right? And then they have like, say 200 seeds come out. Then you got to take those 200 seeds, plant those seeds. Now all those seeds grow differently. Every seed has more of them. One has more of the dad. One has more of the mom, just like any kids do. So then you test each one out. We have to smoke every one of those 200, see which one feels good, which does what. Okay, now let's grow more of this guy. What a terrible job, right? So I was like, which one do we grow more of? So that's when the breeding and the started feeling this whole like creative sense with that. I became like, it's like playing God a little bit, you know, it's like creating new beings and new life, things that are alive. And you're the real. So I started thinking of what we could mix with what to be cool. So I started doing it in real life where I took the two strains, I'd smash them up and grind them up, put them in a joint together. I'd be like, okay, these two taste great together and they feel great. One is the indica, one is the sativa, became a hybrid. So then we put those two together and actually make that plant happen.
Okay.
That was the mixture of those two, you know, and then we try to figure out, you know, it's so cool. And then I love to name, like I love naming songs. I love naming bands. I love naming products. So it's like naming the strains is fun for me, you know, by the look, by the taste, by the feel.
Is there like a vibe you're going for with your strains? What's the vibe?
I don't know. Just different. You know, like there's brands out there that's mostly like they candy names, you know, they have like fruit cake and gelato, you know, and stuff like that. Mine is more like I named one So Delicious. I named another Blacklist, Nightfall. I have Church because it smells like frankincense. Just different, man. It got a little more edgier. My names are edgier. You know, I have, I have like Lemon Dozer because it's like a sleep. It's induces sleep, but it's very lemony. So it's a Lemon Dozer, kind of like a bulldozer, fucks you up, but it's lemon. Right. I can't think of them all right now, but there's so many. We have, and then we kind of took over some of the like legacy strains that are like popular, like the Animal Mints. Those are just a beautiful strain that just is really good that everyone loves. The Mimosas, those are great. But I love to like have our own, you know? So we started only in Cali. And then we met people in other states and distribution companies. And once I brought in a new CEO to like run the game, it was just me and two of my boys, you know? Once we got the whole corporate vibe going, business vibe going, we got a new business model. And now we're scaling on to different states. So now it's more of a growth. So We teamed up with a grow and a distributor in Arizona. Now we're one of the top brands in Arizona. And awesome. We just popped up in Las Vegas. We're with a huge distributor and grow in Las Vegas. So we're in all the shops in Las Vegas.
It's kind of like beer, like you give the formula to another
distributor. You give them the formula, like a Coca-Cola model, where they have distributors all over the place. You give them your packaging, your formula, and say, do it this way. You teach them how to do it your way. Because our benefit is that we have one of the greatest growers from Los Angeles, California, who has shaped the kind of the style of grows that California is known for. He's been around for like 20 years, even when it was the black market, he was around at that time. And he's moved on to the clean, all legit, licensed everything, yeah. permitted everything. Yeah. And I made him a partner. Once I saw how badass he was, I was like, this guy shouldn't just get paid. He should be a partner. He should feel like this is his company, which is it is. And he's going to strive to make it the best it is. So we use his model for every state. So when we go, we say we have a guy and we have a way that we like to grow our stuff. So it's mm-hmm. the same. So he goes out there for a week. He teaches them his ways. He gives them his just like logistics of how you do it, the way he does it, the way he's known to do it. And I'm sure everyone's down to learn from a pro from California. I've
never heard like this side of it. This is a really interesting to me, you know?
It is. It's cool. I mean, I had to learn that too. Remember, I was just a smoker. And so we send him out. And it's illegal right now to send cuts out, which is like already babies. So we have to start from scratch with seeds, you know? So we'll send them seeds and then they'll take the seeds, plant the seeds, make the baby. So it takes a while. It's not like the next day we have something selling, you know? They have to grow it, make sure. And then I do all the quality control. I fly out there. I do whatever I have to do. And like, I meet everybody. I taste everything. I make sure everything's quality. It's growing the same, looks the same, smells the same. Because, you know, you don't want to have every state have something different named the same. You know, it wouldn't be cool. I'm trying to, if I'm putting my name on this, bro, it needs to be what I use and what I smoke and what I swear by. So new news, we're about to hit Oklahoma, which is fucking badass. Oklahoma just got legal like a year ago.
Right.
And we're about to be in Oklahoma. So that's something that we're moving forward.
Is that exclusive No Fucking Regrets podcast information?
Pretty much. Right, yeah, pretty much. I'm not supposed to say it, but I'm saying it. We're about to stomp over Oklahoma. Yeah. So that's going to be rad because we've never gone that far east, you know?
That's amazing that Oklahoma, you know, a place dead set of the Midwest like that is opening up. That's huge progress.
Blows my mind. Awesome. I'm proud to be in the center of it. And, you know, contrary to popular thought that I'm like making bank, what I do is I put everything back in, bro. At the moment, it needs to go all back in. I don't, you know, I'm building a brand that hopefully one day when like Marlboro comes in, they choose my brand to like buy out, you know, I'm looking, you know, or a piece of it, you know, that's the end game. Until then, I'm going to build the best brand out there, bro. The most clean, the most quality. I have to swear by it or else don't buy it, you know? No, that's crazy. I have to swear by it or don't buy it. That's
I thought that might have been your thing right there. That's good. You got to go with that.
So that's, and then also for apparel, we're like I said, I'm also loving the clothing and shit. So whatever we make is not like merch. We're not like just putting our logo on a shirt and selling it. We're making sure it's something cool. People could wear it and like always wear it. It stands 100 washes. It'll still be the same. I'm adding cool little things. Like we're... The brand is for the artists. It's like known for promoting art and the artist mind, you know, the creative. It's for the creative. So we have a new thing we're about to do. We're about to drop on everybody. We're working with street artists and we're going to be sponsoring street artists to go do street art in the
world. Cool.
Buy 22 Red, but they can do whatever they want. But the tag is that. And we're putting that together. We're going to put them on packages. We're going to put their art on packaging and merch. Yeah, bro. Cool. Like I want to honor the creatives out there, bro. You know, I think growing is an art at this moment, you know, like to do it right. There's all the people that do it the same way, which is textbook. And then there's ones that like my guy, Sudo, Surreal Yields. That's his, he has his brand name. We're also bringing him on as a side brand from our brand. We're giving him a whole section of, he can do whatever he wants on that, you know, because we've become this company, but we want to give him the ability to be an artist that he is, you know? So we're doing that. You can follow him. His thing is Surreal Yields, which is all his yielding is surreal because most people grow. Here's something. Most lights
surreal
are
real yields. Is that what you're saying? Surreal yield.
Surreal yield. Because you measure weed growth with lights. So like each light is supposed to bring in about 2 pounds of weed, right? Every harvest. His grows up to 4. He's like double. It's surreal. The yield that his plants grow are like surreal. Like, so it's a great name for him. So we're going to bring that on as a side, like a sister brand. Yeah, bro. So much. Like, I love being creative and it's part of it for me, you know?
So. Take me back to, you growing up. I read a little bit about, you know, your journey from Armenia to, you know, it's a fucking crazy story. Like, it's pretty crazy. No, and I was interested. I was listening to something else you done, and you were talking about how just where Armenia was located and its kind of political, you know,
terrible right now. What went down in Armenia is really bad. We lost. When I say we lost, is we signed something away that we should have never. We gave lands away that we shouldn't have given. But you know, right now because of that treaty, we kind of got the country split in half with how people feel about the prime minister, because he signed this treaty to end the war.
Recently.
This is, okay. Remember, you know, what we're raising money for with system and stuff. Well, there was this. So, okay, I should start from the beginning. So Armenia is in the middle of. Armenia used to be, most of the Caucasus was Armenia. Armenia is one of the oldest countries out there. You know, we're like the first Christians ever. We're the first nation ever to accept Christianity as a national religion, which is kind of like we've been screwed ever since, because our neighbors are all. Our neighbors are all Muslim or different religions, you know, which are very strong. And I have nothing against any religion, by the way. So I want to say that right off the bat. But they do. The ones that are like very extreme, the extremists do. It's everything's a holy war. And because we're strategically, so there was the 1915 genocide of the Armenians by the Ottoman Turkish Empire, Talat Pasha. That was the guy, the main guy that like,
something that's not really even spoken about in American culture.
No, of course not. Why would they? Yeah.
I honestly didn't even hear about it until you guys started talking about it. And then I read up and I was like, holy shit, that's fucking.
This shit went down in the 20th century. That we had 2 million Armenians. We had 2 million, 2.1, I think. And 1.5 were massacred, gone. So 500,000-600,000 people survived. And that's why I'm here. Or else I wouldn't have been here. You know, like my ancestors were the lucky ones, you know? So we're strategically in the middle.
Took a different last name or something, right? Like
my last name is Odadjian, but that's kind of has a Turkish pronunciation in it. So I'm thinking that I don't think it was my last name prior to 1915. I think that that was given to my ancestors because I tried to do some research and there is no other Odadjian out there. There's none. I did the ancestry thing and it says 100% Armenian. It says, I guess me personally, I was right in the middle of that. That's where both my mom and dad's ancestors were from the same area.
Do you remember being a kid in Armenia? Do you remember?
I remember just snow and shit like that. I remember playing with the kids, with my neighbors. I was 5 years old. We left when I was 5. And I remember playing outside. I remember my family's house. I remember like snow. I remember the neighborhood. You know, it was a major time, bro. Imagine a five-year-old from country to many other countries until he settles in Hollywood. You know, like I went from Armenia.
You're allowed to move to America, right? So you had to move to someplace else.
We weren't. The borders, you know how they said all the borders were closed for Trump? Dude, back then all the borders were closed. But no one needs to talk back then. Everyone hates Trump, so they talk about it. All the borders of America were closed. You couldn't come from Russia to America. And we were a part of the USSR at the time. We were a republic because they had taken us over, which is this whole thing with Artsakh and the war that just happened was because of back then in 1920, I think Stalin gave a bunch of Armenian lands to Azerbaijan, made Azerbaijan a country just to appease Turkey. And so our lands were given away. And then when the Soviet Union broke apart, we took our lands back. And then now what happened is they attacked us and took that back for them. Like that's what the whole feud is. Like, you know, it's our lands with our ancestors living on there for thousands of years. And they just right now just demolished it, broke apart our monasteries, our churches, like blowing that shit up, trying to erase history and say we were here first. But they came in like 1920.
I've read a bunch of this, and just your little like 20-second explanation of it right there, like broke it down better for me than I now I understand it all. Yeah,
it's like all in like the worse than Hitler, motherfucker, appeased Turkey at the time by saying, okay, take this land that's available for me because I can take it and appease your people. So they started this new country called Azerbaijan in 1920. Azerbaijan doesn't go further than that. They're not a country. They were a republic. They became a Soviet Union republic. Then when the Soviet Union broke apart in 88 or 90, I don't know when it was, that's when Armenia took it back. Like, okay, like this is our land, so let's take it back. Our people are still living there. They kept on living there throughout those whole times that it was called Azerbaijan. It was still Armenians living there. They didn't move. So what happened is like they just came in and said, okay, we're taking it back. Fuck you. You have to walk away. So all these old people, we have over 100,000 displaced people right now. That's what we're raising money for the soldiers that went, fought, lost limbs, and for some families that were displaced, you know? So anyways, back to where I come from. I come from that area. So what's happening right now is Turkey is trying to get rid of Armenia and attach themselves to Azerbaijan so they could be one huge empire again, which is really bad for the rest of the world if you really think about it, because those guys are dictators and they hide everything they do, and they have lobbyists, and they have a lot of money because they have the oil and the gold mines and the diamond mines. They're very rich in resources, right? And so they use that against what they're doing, and the world succumbs to money. So it doesn't matter if you're a terrorist. If you're going to supply us money, we're going to be quiet. That's what the world is. That's what America is right now. So hence, when we talk about this going on, people call it a conflict. It ain't no conflict, bro. We don't have a conflict. We were living there, our people. They came and threw us out, murdered us, and they're calling it a conflict. Like, no, it's a genocide. It's a fucking massacre. It ain't a conflict. We're just protecting our land. They're attacking. It's not a conflict. Anyways. So my parents wanted a better life for me. So in 1979, they had to jump through hoops to get us to America. So we first had to move to Moscow, live there for a little while, then moved to Rome, became citizens of Rome as refugees, then moved us to Queens. I was living in New York for a few months.
In Italy, yeah.
I could have been in New York. You know, I could have turned, you know, I would have never been in a band. It'd be so different, you know?
I just lost your sound. Can you hear me?
Oh, I'm here. Hello?
Can you hear me?
I can hear you. Hold on. No, I'm there.
Hello? Oh, there, you're back.
Yeah, okay. Well, cut, that part goes away. So, where was I?
You were moved to Rome.
Moved to Rome, and then from Rome we moved to Queens. We were going to be East Coasters. My dad's family moved, because we moved as a whole people. It wasn't like only like five of us. It was like 20 of us moved. Like my, my dad's cousins, uncles, aunts, everybody just kind of moved together.
That, you know, I got to say that like, that's crazy. Like I can't, you know, like that's fucking to move to a different country, then move to another different country, then move to a different continent.
Another continent. Yes, bro. It's crazy. But that's what I mean by jumping over hoops to get to some.
Determined to get out of there, you know?
That's how bad it was, bro. No one wants to be in control of the USSR, bro, under the control of the USSR. That's how it was back then. It was a communist nation. So we were just this like communist republic, you know? So then my dad's family moved to Hollywood. And right on Kingsley Drive, North Kingsley, they moved to North Kingsley. So me and my mom moved a month later after my dad moved with his mom and brother and stuff. We moved and met up with my dad, and we were a family again. For a second, I didn't have a dad, you know? And we united on North Kingsley Drive, and I grew up there till I was 17 years old. And that's when I was like, learned how to play guitar and learned how to skateboard. And that's what I did from. There was gang bang, like MS, the gang MS started on my street, the Long Pre, where the Natural Fudge Cafe was. I lived on Natural Fudge Cafe. I lived on that street. That was where from my apartment, I can watch the Natural Fudge's front door and see all the punk rockers. So I was like, fuck, I want to, like, that's my shit, right? And I'd see.
I mean, you must have just been ripping out too. Like, I mean, what a fucking dream. Like, you're literally like, I'm going to go to Hollywood.
know, like, I didn't know what Hollywood was. They just went there. It was like it just all happened. Like, I was this, and my parents worked 2-3 jobs. I was raised by my grandma. So I was like, I had my skateboard and Hollywood. They weren't like very strict. I was all over. We would skate to fucking Vine and shit. Now, that was my area, bro. It was my hood. Like, I knew every alley, I knew every tree, I knew every block, I knew all the people, all the gangbangers. I knew everyone knew me as that kid from the block that just skateboarded and was righteous. And I even tried to get into gangs and shit, but they would exclude me. They would be like, "Nah, dude, you're not like us." Like, a lot of my friends died back then. Like, I remember like hearing, "Oh, you know, Alex is gone. Oh, Wimmy is gone. Like, oh, he got stabbed and died in the hospital." Like, fuck. Like, I grew up like that. And I just never, luckily, I should say, knock on wood, I came out of that learning a lot, being strong, you know, a lot of character, I guess, you know, taught me a lot. So
you went to school with Darren and Serge, right?
Yeah.
But didn't know each other.
Didn't know, no. I knew Darren, but that's, I didn't know. Crazy. Is that crazy? Yeah. It was a private school right in Hollywood.
Okay. You said you knew Darren or you didn't know Darren?
I knew of him because he was only a year younger. Serge was like 5 years, 6 years older. So I didn't really, I had heard of him, but I didn't know him. When they told me he was from Pilibos, I was like, oh, I think I remember seeing him, but we never associated. But Darren, I remember because he was only one grade younger for the time that he was there. So I remember him. I just don't, we never were friends, you know? We never like hung out.
All Armenian kids or
yeah, it was an Armenian. It's still around. It's still there. The school's there. It's an Armenian private school called Alex Pilibos Armenian School. Rose and Alex Pilibos. It's on Alexandria and Hollywood right there, right? Smack dab in the East Hollywood, right?
I mean, that's cool that you got to go to you know, still have that same culture that your family was used to. And
not nuts. Like my parents having no money, working odd jobs. Like my dad used to work at CNR, drive a lunch truck. My mom worked at a supermarket back then, and the little amount of money they had, they could have purchased a house, but we lived in an apartment on Kingsley while they paid for a private school so I can keep my culture and keep my, like, you know about my culture and my race and learn Armenian and speak it. That's why I could write and read Armenian right now, and I could speak it. It's just because of that, you know, because of them. At the time, I was like, you guys are crazy. Throw me in a fucking public school. I'll be better off, you know? But they were like, no, you know, you got to wear a uniform and you have to go and you have to be like this. You got to cut your hair. You can't have long hair. I was always wanting to be a Hessian. I couldn't. I was always, you know, always had a fucking mullet. Never, never could go long like that. Yeah, dude. That's what made the whole thing, I guess. And then when we, I used to put ads out in Recycler to like join bands and shit. And so I found these guys I was jamming with and we were in a studio in Burbank.
You're playing guitar?
I was playing guitar. No, actually I started playing bass in that band. The first band I played bass for, because I went and traded in my, I had a Randall, badass Randall, Dimebag Daryl, fucking Randall half stack. That fucker was the best sounding, but I traded that in for a Sound Gear Ibanez. And now you look back going, fuck, you should have kept the fucking Randall.
Let me talk about system for a little bit here, since you got to get going here pretty quick.
Sure.
Since,
sure.
You know, it's a big part of your life.
Bro, come on now.
Part of your life.
Yeah. That's how we met, bro. That's how you and I met. So
I know, right? Right.
Are you in LA? Where are you at?
I'm in the Bay Area.
Bay Area? We got to kick it.
We should. I know. I mean, it's like we're close, but we're not.
We're not. I know. Especially during the COVID era, we're further than we should be. But let me know if you're ever in LA, man. You're always welcome over. Let's grab something.
I remember when System first came on my radar. We had your demo came into our hand. I want to say there was like somebody like tied up or something with like ropes.
Yeah, that was my first attempt at a branding. It was someone I knew from high school. Literally, he was schizophrenic. It was the first cover, the first album, the one where he was tied up, not the cellophane one, but the one with the rope. So, and he was like, he always had like a clean cut look with glasses, looking like a businessman. But that look, you know, there's this look he gave, eerie. I was like, you'd look good tied up, bro. And then he was like, what? Like, what the fuck are you talking about? But I told him, I go, yeah, I got this band and we're about to do a cover, a sticker. There was no band yet. There was a band, but I don't think we had music yet. Or maybe we were started to do music, but we had no shows yet. But I had
managing. You're not even playing bass.
Yeah. Well, the managing was, I was managing Soil, which was Darren, Serge, that guy Dave I'm talking about that I met Sorrow through for North Kingsley in the studio. He was playing bass, and then a drummer from Hawaii. His name was Domingo, who I still have contact with. I talk to him on Facebook sometimes. Really cool guy. Amazing drummer, bro. Guy was killer. So when they, and I was in that same studio, it was called Nightingale Studios in Burbank. I was, that's the recycler band I'm talking about that I started playing bass for the first time when I was like 20. And I saw them coming around. I was like, fuck, man. I know these guys from this old school. I know of them. I started kicking with them. After you know our practice would end, I would go to their room and I would hang out. And when Dave would stop playing bass, I'd grab the bass and I'd play something. And me and Darren would bond. And then they asked me, they said, man, you're like, you know, you're good at talking and you have this energy, you know, why don't you, we don't have a room for a band member. Why don't you manage us? I'm like, fuck, sure. Whatever I can do. At that point I like had some friends. I don't know anything going on in the strip. I have no idea what's happening in LA. I don't know. I've never been to a club. Good old boy from Burbank, Hollywood Burbank, but never did a club thing. I think I'd been to Gazzari's once and saw some like hair metal band in like the late 80s. I think it's the first time I wore my cowboy boots out and my leather jacket.
man, I hate those pictures of that.
Dude, I think I saw Odin. There was a band named Odin back then. I think I saw them. They were Gazzari, in the movie.
Odin.
I think I saw that band. Or was it just because I associate Gazzari's with that? That movie, the Decline of Western Civilization. Penelope, Penelope. So, anyways, so I did that for a little while, and I tried to get him some shows. I knew this girl that knew Zach from Rage, and Zach was throwing parties at his house on Fridays, and he would have bands play.
How cool.
So I got his address from this chick. And I ended up at his house with Serge and that guy Dave I was talking about. I swear I just showed up, bro. Like,
that's fucking awesome.
And Stanford Prison Experiment.
I've never done that. Just so you know, I've never done that.
The reason why they hired me as their manager because I could. So I just showed up. A lot of people. There was a band playing Stanford Prison Experiment, and that's when I discovered that band. I love them till today. They were playing. I was like, fuck, dude, this is such a cool vibe.
This is the night of the party. This is the Friday night of the party.
And it was like a loft, like with high ceilings. And he slept up there in like some little cot or something. And
they're playing in his house?
In his apartment. So it's like a single, it's a studio apartment kind of vibe.
Yeah.
Tall ceilings, like a warehouse. He took a warehouse over. Like, he could rehearse there, do whatever. And I didn't meet Zach, but I met Tom. I saw Tom Morello. Okay. So I was like, hey man, you know, my name is this. I work for a band. I'd love to get them to play here. He's like, dude, you should talk to Zach. I'm sure he'll work it out if it's a good band. I'm like, fuck yeah. Got his information. A week later, the band broke up, Soil. Oh. Right? So that's where that left. But then the bass player hits me up and goes, yo, I got something for you. I know you love Soil. I think Darren wants you to join Soil. I'm like, what the fuck are you talking about? You're the bass player. I'm not going to join Soil. Like, I'm not going to do that.
You know that Darren wants you to join.
Yeah, like, we got into it. He doesn't like me. Blah, blah, blah. This. I'm like, bro, this can't happen. I'm not going to fuck your girlfriend. Like, that's how it felt like. I'm not going to date your ex-girlfriend. You know, like, I'm not doing that. He kept calling me back going, bro, if anyone's going to do it, you should do it. I totally give you the okay. Like, I'm done with it. I don't want to do it. I'm sick of it. I'm going to do my own thing. You do it. You seem like you're down. You're managing it already. Do it. I'm okay with it. I was like, still awkward about it. And then all of a sudden, Darren hits me up. And Darren's never called me back then. Never had hit me up before. He's like, yo, I want you to meet us at Serge's house. I want to talk to you about something. At this point, he didn't know that I already knew. So I showed up and he's like, I got good news and bad news. Good news, I want you to play bass. But bad news, we lost our drummer. So we don't have a drummer. I'm like, okay. So what do you mean you lost a drummer? How am I going to manage a band without a drummer? It's like, well, maybe we should start a whole new band. Maybe we should start something fresh with you. I'm like, you know, that works better for me than me taking the place of my friend's other band. If we start another band, let's do that. Like, let's start from scratch. I'm a creative. A few rules, I said. I need to be able to write. I can't not write music. I can't just play other people's music. I need to write music. I love what you do, but I want to also help. Totally cool with that. And so we started. We didn't have a name, nothing, no drummer, just me, Serge, and Darren. We got another studio on Lancashire in North Hollywood. And Darren and I would, like, Darren would pick me up. We'd drive to Alvarado. We'd get some weed off the street. That's where we'd buy our weed. From some guy on the street corner selling weed.
There was no 22 Red back then.
No 22 Red, bro. It was like we'd get nickel sacks in our hands and ask for doubles. Yeah, bro. So we did that with a 22 in my lap, driving around in a Honda Accord, talking about how badass this band is going to be and what we're going to do and how we're going to do it. And
dream.
Just got close with Darren that way. We'd go to the studio, sit around, smoke, drink, and talk. And we didn't have a drummer for a long time. Serge was older. He had a business. He had this whole thing going on. So we just knew he was there for us when we needed him, and we just kind of put it together ourselves. Got a drummer. It was just going to be just fill in at the time. He stuck. We wrote some songs. Songs became cool. We loved what we were doing. Started naming it. It was going to be Victims of a Down. Darren had written a poem. And I kind of didn't. I started thinking future and started thinking. I was like, dude, if it's a long name. At the time, there weren't very long names. It was like Korn. You know, there was Rage Against the Machine, but there was like Tool. Deftones. You know, like Snot, Deftones. Like, so we were like, I was like, if they're going to break it down, they're going to call us Victims. And I don't want to be known as Victims, like, for the rest of my life. I don't want to be a victim, you know? So he came back. He's like, what about System? I'm like, because you can't say the word system like a pussy. You can say like system. It's like you just got to stress the S's. It's like system. You can't say that. It's like system. And the word down is also down. Like it's forceful the way you say it. I thought it was cool. System of a Down made sense. And I was like, later on,
when you break the Victim of a Down thing,
it wasn't going to work. You know, I was like, branding wise, it didn't work with my whole vibe, you know? I was like, one day they're going to be yelling system only. You know, they're going to just yell system. Not Victim, you know? So that's
the first time I see you guys. I think you're opening for Snot. I want to say the first time I see you guys, I'm in LA. I'm recording my second record, More Things Change.
Yeah.
And you guys play a show with Snot. And
they open for us in LA. Yeah.
What's
they open. They open for us, I think, in LA. We've opened for them in Santa Barbara.
Okay. Maybe, yeah.
So we were switching back and forth. Yeah.
Yeah. I end up getting your demo there. Can't even remember how. I don't even
probably
think I met
me.
Maybe
I probably came up to you
somehow. I got the demo, and I remember taking it back, and we were mixing the record, and we was listening to it, and we were all just like, "Holy shit!" I remember Heathens, just like fucking
War. That was the War one. That was the War demo. Yeah.
And it was fucking. I remember just that middle section came on, and I just got fucking goosebumps. I was like, "Holy fuck, this is fucking awesome!"
Love you.
And then our record dropped. We came out and we were doing some dates. And I think the band that we, you know, like how bands toured back then, like a band would open for 2 weeks and then you'd get somebody else. So we went into the West Coast section and we had 4 dates that we didn't have an opener. And so I was just like, let's see if we can get that System of a Down band. Like we were still all freaking out. And I believe they were the first shows that you guys ever did outside of California, right?
Yeah. We stayed in Cali. We only played LA. We played Orange County, and we used to play Santa Barbara because it's not. And that's all we did. Corona, we played once, I remember.
Right.
And then you guys took us out. I think we did the Glass House, right?
Yes, we did Corona at the Showcase.
Showcase Theater. Yeah. Oh, wow.
Showcase. We did the Las Vegas, Arizona.
The Huntridge in Las Vegas. I'll never forget that show ever in my life. That was the first time we ever got booed and shit. Like,
oh my God. And I gotta say something about this. And I know you've talked about it. I always think it's funny, but man, I mean, we thought in my head, everybody's going to fucking love this band. I mean, this is fucking, I'm loving this. Everybody fucking hated your guts. I was like, oh my God. Like it was so fucking brutal some nights. Like, and that was back when I loved this too, because that was like, this is what I call like angry Surge. Like Surge was all pissed off, like if people are like, fuck you, man, just fuck you, like he'd just get up and like be screaming. And I was like, where's that dude now? That dude's long gone.
But like, that dude doesn't exist, bro. He's like all nice to people. I was like, yeah, that's right. You hate me, I love you. I'm like, fuck, dude, where's your this, bro? I'm like,
back then he was fuck you, yeah. Man. He was so fucking pissed.
Can't believe you remember that, bro. We had that kind of that was the first time ever we felt that was on that stage, right? Where they were, remember, it was a Halloween show.
Right.
They had pumpkins all over the
bill. That was on the bill too. Yeah.
That they threw pumpkins on stage. We were getting hit by pumpkin pieces. And then I remember John got it. Was it John? We had John at the time, correct? Or was it? Yeah, we had John. John, because we switched drummers. Remember, we had the old drummer and then John came in before we got signed. And they threw a Dr. Pepper bottle and hit John in the head while he was playing.
That's not cool, man.
but it happened. And so anyway, we had that kind of
fans, man. What the fuck?
They hated us, bro. They were like, fuck you guys, wearing makeup, playing the song Sugar. Like, fuck you. Yeah, we were putting makeup on and shit, like Kiss, bro.
Oh, yeah, so, like you guys had a favorite thing, and
bro, we had a whole. We had that wasn't the last of us getting hated on it. Slayer took us out, bro, and you guys.
I was gonna say I hung out with you guys on the Slayer show. You guys were opening. I can't remember who was supporting, but it was still Clutch. It was really Clutch. Fucking.
It was Slayer, yeah, bro.
that was a brutal one too, and you guys fucking toughed it out, man. Like you just kept on going. Surge never stopped. Still angry. What was Angry Surge?
One time, bro. Okay. The worst one, I'll tell you. So you want a quick story again? So we're in Poland with Slayer again. It was like in November. It's ice cold.
This is your first two tours are opening for Slayer.
Slayer in America and Europe, bro.
They you into the frying pan and like, you know. Like,
you're not swim. Slayer. You're wearing makeup and you're singing Sugar. Like, get the fuck out of here, right? So they loved our spunk. They kind of like, because we are these kids that are like, fuck you. We've been through hell. We'll be through hell again. We're here. We were just intrigued that bands like you and Slayer liked us because we loved you guys. So we're like, if they dig us, then fuck everybody else. You know, if our heroes like us, then fuck everybody else. That was our whole thing. Everyone will get it. If they don't get it now, they'll get it someday because the people we listen to us now. Yes. That was our mentality. Europe Slayer. So we're in Poland and bro, it's like it's a sea of people, right? And it's with Sepultura. Sepultura hadn't joined yet. So it was this Polish band called Vader. I don't know if you remember Vader.
Yes.
Remember Vader? Brutal. So yeah, very brutal. So it was like us, Vader, and Slayer. And dude, they wouldn't let us fucking play, bro. I swear every song was like more booing and loudness than and you know, when you're opening, your volume's down. On the in-house, yeah. So no one's hearing you really, and so we're hearing them louder than we can hear our music, bro. And there was like SS flags, bro, like fucking Nazi flags. No joke, bro. Like fuck you, you guys are Middle Easterners. Like we're not Middle Easterners. We're from the Caucasus, but still we're too close to the Middle East. So we're like we're Middle East, right? So death threats, fuck you. The final thing was a bagel came flying through the crowd. Hit Serge in the face. The fucking Serge comes out. Serge stops the show. Fuck you guys. Boom, boom. And I swear the crowd went like this. Like when he came up, like the crowd just parted. He was like going to jump in the crowd and start throwing fucking punches, bro. And that happened. And we stopped playing. We left, bro. That's the first time and only time we didn't finish the show was that show at Poland.
Oh, wow.
Now, yeah. Fast forward through our career, and we keep going to Europe, but we just, for some reason, our touring agency didn't book us in Poland. It wasn't because we didn't want to go back to Poland again, because that shit happened to us in Germany and happened in Czechoslovakia, everywhere, you know? But they just never booked us in Poland again. So we never thought about it. We're like, you know how it is when you're young and you're touring, they just tell you where to go, you go, you know? You're not even thinking.
Yeah.
So in 2017, we went to Poland again. After popular demand of going back there, and everyone thinks
go back all of that time. Holy shit!
That's 2017. Now been to Poland, right? So the fans have a fuck their PTSD. They think that we're not going because of that. What the ancestors did to us. They heard the stories. We got booed off. They think we're like mad at them, and we're not. We're boycotting. We're not boycotting shit. We just don't. Never got booed.
System of a down mythology. Like they're never coming.
Never coming back to Poland. So, bro, during war, I think, which is, I think, when the fucking the thing came at us, the bagel with cream cheese on it or butter on it that hit Serge's face, the crowd had balloons. I'm talking like thousands, colorful balloons, and they blew them up during war, and now it's like a carnival. Like there's Whoa. Balloons, and they're like smiling, like we're here, we're so sorry.
That's amazing, so, though.
And I'm like playing, and I'm chill. Like,
oh my god, wow. I just got. I'm just thinking about it.
What's happening? Incredible. Like the balloons coming at us, bro. Like it was like this party. Like we're sorry, we love you. Like kind of vibe, and I was just like, wow, bro. Like it's just that, like you know, the yin and the yang of like what could go down in the same place. I think it was the same place we played too. Just like a theater, you know, like regular theater with no seats, you know, and. Yeah, that happened in 2017. So That's we went amazing. Back and we got balloons instead of fucking beer cans. And, oh, they would throw the European dollars at us. I still have a couple of scars that will never go away from that tour. They used to right. beam us. We'd slice
the first one, on the Slayer tour, yeah. Slayer,
dude, they would slice us up, bro. With
When did it get easy for you? I mean, like, toxicity was huge.
No, it changed. Toxicity.
That was number one, right? That wasn't the number one.
We debuted number one. It was on fucking 9/11. We debuted 2001 on the day. I said story before. I found out on the same phone call that 9/11's happening, like the fucking towers are falling and we're terrorist shit going on and we're number one on Billboard was on the same call.
Wow.
So I was like bittersweet shit going on. Yeah.
Right. And I remember you guys had done some like shows in LA. You did like a free show or something in LA and it was like,
that blew. Madness. That was right. Labor Day the week before of 9/11. It was Labor Day. And we were going to do a show for a Club Vinyl, outside of Club Vinyl. And they expected, I don't know, 4,000 or 5,000 people, but like 20,000 showed up, 15,000 on the streets for free. And the fire marshal didn't let us play and the place went buck wild. And I remember getting bused to like, or chartered into the Roosevelt Hotel, gave us some rooms. And we're like hearing helicopters, we're watching TV, and like, we couldn't have paid for that publicity, bro. No way. You could have paid $10 million, $20 million, and you wouldn't have had channel 2, 4, 5, 7, 9, 11, and 13 blasting live riots of LA. Why is it being called banned? System of the Down, like the Down, like all these other, didn't even know our real name. LA band releasing a record tomorrow, you know, there was no, you know, that's, it was like clockwork. It was like, it was written in scripture, how it should go down. And that was like, I swear, it was nothing we planned for. It was just, it happened. And next thing you know, we're like this fucking biggest band ever all of a sudden for that time being because of what happened, you know? And I remember watching the news and I was seeing my gear on the corner of like Sunset and Vine. And there's some chick fucking breaking my fucking head with a hammer. Like, what are you doing? Like,
amp, you son of a bitch.
Yeah, it's got sense. Then like people getting pulled over with all our gear, guitars in their car, they're stealing. Yeah, I was watching my crew fighting people off on the stage before they attacked the stage and shit. Because our gear was all up, ready to play.
Yeah, you guys did have wild shows back then, though. Like the shows were wild. You know, like I got to say, I remember, I saw you, I mean, I've seen, we've played many festivals together. A bunch of times, but I remember going to see you at I want to say it was Ozfest at the Shoreline, and it was Disturbed, and you guys were the headliners, maybe? Or
we were co-headlining with Ozzy. Disturbed.
Oh, okay, was Ozzy still playing?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, and I just remember that show. We hung out at that show, and you brought me up on stage and like watched from the side, and I was watching you and I were watching Disturbed for a while, and nothing against Disturbed. I love Disturbed, like great songs, super nice guys, like whatever. But you know, they kind of, this was like the height of the USA chants and fucking, you know, all this shit, and I was just like, you know, he gave some big speech about like go heavy metal this and heavy, and then like they went into this just booty rock fucking radio, and I was like what you know, what the fuck, what do I know, like these motherfuckers are selling millions of records and they
so
yeah, what the fuck do I know?
They're doing something right. Yeah,
I don't get it. And then you guys came on and it was just fucking, it was weird and it was bedlam and like fucking security trying to throw people, and you're running up and kicking the fucking security guard in the back of the head, and fucking Darren's spinning around like some fucking crazy acid fucking person. And like, he's like, everybody, like at some point he just looks up into the crowd. He's like, everybody dance. And like, everybody poured into the aisles and started dancing. I was like, I get this. Like, this is what I get. Like, this is, it was just so much fucking chaos.
And chaos. That's the word. We caused chaos and they agreed. They kind of joined in. And it was like, to me, this is all bittersweet because I think we can still do it. But because of like misunderstandings within band members, we're not doing it. Like, look at us. We have a common cause. We get together. We do two songs, two videos. The same as they, like, you know, I'm that member that like still everyone's like best friends of mine, but they're not best friends with each other so much. They are, but they have differences in opinions of stuff. I have a way of like understanding each member and saying, dude, we can overcome this. You know, like, it's not that big of a deal. No one cussed no one's mom out. No one fucking banged anyone's wife. No one did any of those things that can really destroy a relationship. It's just a difference in opinion of things. And I think people should be worked that out. But because I think of what we had, I think it's like some people are stuck in what we had and some people want to move forward and not do what we had and do something totally different, which is wrong too. I don't think we should do something totally different. I think we should do something that we both agree. And it's just, we're having a hard time meeting that. And that's why we are. So to me, it's bittersweet because I see everybody and everyone's like, oh, we love Shavo's. And I'm like, I love you. But then they're like, you can't work together because everyone wants a different, not everyone, it's like two, they want a different.
Surgeon Darren.
I'm not naming nothing, bro. I'm just, you know, I'm just saying they have, it's a different thought.
Why can't we name who it is?
Like, I don't know, because sometimes it's not. Sometimes it's, you know, John sometimes says something that's like not agreeable to, you know? Right, but it's like, I don't think anything is like, so horrible has happened. You know, we're all alive. We're all friends. We are really, like, I swear, when there's conversations going on, it's very like legit, very loving. No one's hating on each other. They're very polite towards each other. Serge and Darren, they like when they talk, they're like connected. They're nice to each other. No one's hating. No one's cussing. No one's saying fuck you. No one's saying you ruined. You did this. Nothing.
Don't want to write music together.
It's just that section that's fucked up. And like, you know, Darren brought these songs in and we've worked that way before. Like a song like War was brought in by Darren, you know what I mean? Like Heathens, that was a Darren song. Darren brought that in and that happened. Then there's a song like Sugar where I brought that in, you know what I mean? Or No. And there's a song like Question where Serge brought it. So we have different ways of writing songs. It should be like that again, but I feel like it's because of what's happened. I feel like it's kind of like, it's become this big issue now where I think at the end of things, when we're old and gray, we're going to look back and be like, fuck, we were idiots for not taking the time and seizing the day. I believe in seizing the day in everything I do. And that's what I do. That's why I'm so busy nowadays, but I'd love to have that in my life too. And not say like, you know, we can't work things out. I think it's all work. Like I said, I'm telling you here, there's nothing that's happened that can't be worked out. Yeah. So I always have hope, you know? I'm doing everything knowing that system's not dead. And it hasn't been dead. It's just...
And I think it's amazing that you guys can still feel this way and tour together and play fucking killer shows. And
we're still doing that,
Or at least and, but then when it comes to writing something new...
It sucks because it's there too. Like, I've got... Like, remember I was saying how I work with North Kingsley? I work, like, on the spot. I have, like, on my phone, I have my, like, my photo area. I have videos of me, like, because I don't write music. I write music, and then I record it, so I remember it. Same here. I have files and files of system riffs that I've written when they can go to system, and I'm not sharing that with anybody. I'm just, that's not going to North Kingsley. I told you how North Kingsley is written. That's there whenever needed. I got it. Like when the bullshit is over, whenever, if and ever it is, I'm going to be submitting music. I have music to submit. I'm sure Darren has tons of shit because that's all he does is do that. And I'm sure Serge has some shit too.
Is it part of the pressure though, that you guys got so big and, you know, you achieved did you guys do three number one records in a row?
I think so. That's what happened after Toxicity On.
Yeah.
Yeah. When we did Mesmerize, Hypnotize, both of them hit number one in the same year. And they were totally separate records.
And the pressure to follow that up. You know, do you want to not have a number one record? You know,
I don't think that's even a thing. I don't think that's even a thing. I'm not pressured. I don't think anyone is. Look, we just did two songs and doesn't seem, you could have put those songs on other records of ours. Yeah. Totally. The way I hear it, you could put Genocidal Humanoids on the first record, bro. And it wouldn't feel like it was out of place.
Yeah.
It fits on all five records. You know, you could put them anywhere. All three songs. I'm all both songs. And that's because Darren writes according to what the situation is. But it's also a matter of, because Darren had written Protect the Land for Scars on Broadway. You know what I mean? His side project. Mm-hmm. But it's that version. We heard that version. It's not the version you're hearing. When we come in and, you know, I do the bass and Serge's vocals, Vaughn's drumming, he adds something. There's different. I'm not saying it's better or worse. It's just different, you know. Yeah. Same song has a different life with System and with Scars. You know, all our projects. Serge has his solo stuff going on. I'm sure if he brings those songs into System and we do what we do to it, it's going to sound like System. Solo, it's going to sound like Serge only, you know. So I feel like we're so strong together that it's kind of ludicrous for us not to do it. So I'm like part of the fans. I'm like a fan. I'm going, fuck, what the hell is wrong with us? The fuck is wrong with you guys? Like, let's just do it, bro. It's like a month out of our fucking year. Let's get in there and do what we do. And it's not even a, you know, but it is what it is, bro.
Do you feel like that these two songs that you did have kind of tested the waters and like kind of given you some, you know, almost like what you did with North Kingsley? Like you're kind of going, okay, we put this out. What do you guys think? Cool. All right. People still
They're loving it, bro. People are loving it. Like I read comments, you know, they're like, fuck, it's like they never left. And then, but we're not planning on the future. We haven't planned on anything after that yet. Nothing. Right now we're like.
And that's hard for people to wrap their heads around. Like what? Fuck. There's no future.
This must be the beginning of an album. I'm like, no, it's not. I wish it was because I personally would get a kick out of that. I love it. I love performing with the guys. I love being in the studio with the guys. It's anxiety causing because I don't know what's going to happen, but it's kind of like I live off that. That kind of drives me, you know, that not knowing drives me. And I think it'd be rad, but it takes more than one to tango.
You're liking the feeling of anxiety now.
Because I can live with it now without taking the pill.
Yeah, after 20 years of not feeling it.
You know? Yeah, yeah. So yeah, bro, there it is. In a nutshell, there's nothing horrible that's happened. It's just a disagreement on style and tactic of how to do it. That's all.
Well, I gotta say, man, this has been really cool. You know, you're.
Oh yeah, I love talking to you, bro.
One of my favorite bands. You're actually both of my kids' first favorite song.
Aw, come on, that's
kind of a dance song. Love you know, it. Like I don't even know, we listened to it, but like they just both latched on. It's funny, my oldest latched on to "I'm Just Sitting." Oh my god, I had to listen to that song 7,000 fucking times, Shavo.
I'd be sick of it. Like enough, motherfucker.
And then my youngest listening to Old School Hollywood.
Hollywood. So there you go. Different songs, right? That different caliber of songs, but still the same band.
Totally. And you know, yeah. Best of luck with everything, man. Congratulations.
I appreciate you, bro.
Putting out new music and you know, continuing to just stay productive and all the shit that you're doing. It's been awesome. Been a great guest.
Thank you, brother. I appreciate it. You're a great host, man. Loved doing this. I didn't plan on being 2 hours, but let's do 2 hours more, bro. No, I'm just kidding. I gotta run, but I love talking to you, bro. And I miss us hanging out. Let's do that whenever possible.
Fuck yeah.
I feel like we're always going to be cool. So yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, the mighty, mighty Shavo, System of the Down, North Kingsley, 22 Red. With Robb Flynn.